being New Year's, I think about the New Year's holiday, and my opinion is it's kind of a manufactured, created holiday. There's nothing holy about a new calendar year, and there's nothing organically that happens on January 1st all by itself, so there's really nothing special about New Year's. And life doesn't divide itself up conveniently like we do. Right? We divide life into various years and decades and centuries. Right? I went and bought some music, that, you know, the music of the 70s, and here's the music of the 80s. Well, music doesn't divide itself into decades like that. There was nothing appreciably different between the music on December 31st, 1979, and January 1st, 1980. It didn't just suddenly change. Our lives don't just suddenly change because it becomes a new year. But we do something in interaction with the new year that I think is really beneficial. We can use that to mark a date on a calendar. And we can say, from this date, as the calendar represents a new beginning of a calendar year, it's going to also represent a new beginning for my life in these areas. And we set resolutions, right? How many have set resolutions this year? So for both of you, I commend you. So what I want to do today is talk about who God is, who Jesus, in fact, said he was, how he described himself. And I'm going to ask you, while we're having that talk, would you think to yourself, is that who God is in my life? Do I need more of God like that in my life? And if so, would you mark this date on your calendar and resolve today that in this new year, you're going to move closer to God? If you're feeling today like maybe I'm farther away from God than I once was, I think my question would be, who moved? And we can take steps, if we're feeling farther away from God, we can take steps to move closer to God. And we'll talk about that as we go along as well. Let's start with the scripture, starting in Exodus chapter 3. Moses said to God, "If I come to the people of Israel and I say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'Well, what is his name?' what shall I say to them?" And God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Say this to the people of Israel, 'I am has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations.'" So letter A, God introduced himself to Moses as I am. Number one, I am is the translation of the Hebrew word into English of the name of God. We call that the tetragrammatron. It's a big fancy word that means the four-letter word. And the four letters are YHWH, and commonly we call that Yahweh. That was the name of God. That was the most common name of God used in the Old Testament. Used more than 7,000 times in the Old Testament. Everybody knew that when they heard that, that was the name of God. And that's what God said to Moses in that passage. I am, Yahweh has sent you. Number two, it is the essence of God, the eternal, the immutable, the Lord, the Almighty One, the Creator, and the Savior. All of that is contained in those four letters. This is Almighty Sovereign God. And number three, the Jews were familiar with the name of God and what it meant. Because this was the most common name used for God in the Old Testament, all of the Jews recognized it. And they all knew the power and authority and sovereignty contained in that name. This is only the name of Almighty God. Well, interestingly, about 1,500 years after Moses had that conversation with God, Jesus was speaking to a group of Jews. And that group of Jews, by the way, were very familiar with that name of God. And Jesus used that name, I am, to describe himself. So in John 8:58, Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him. So letter B, 1,500 years later, Jesus called himself, I am. Now, the words rendered was and am are very different. The reason I point that out is because this wasn't a mistake. It could read, before Abraham was brought into being, I exist. So Jesus knew exactly what he was saying. It wasn't a mistake. And the Jews knew exactly what he was saying too. And they picked up stones so they could throw the stones at him until he was dead. Because he just equated himself with Almighty God. He just committed a sin of blasphemy that was unforgivable to them, and they wanted to kill him for calling himself God. Number two, the Jews wanted to stone Jesus to death for blasphemy. Everyone there recognized that he was declaring his divinity. So the first I am that Jesus used was saying, I am God. So I want to look further. Jesus used that I am statement several times during his ministry, and I want to look at just a handful of those, and let's talk about who Jesus said he is. So let us see, who does Jesus say that he is? Let's take a quick look at some of those I am statements that Jesus made. Number one, Jesus said, I am the Alpha and the Omega. Alpha, letter A, Alpha and Omega are the first and the last letters of the Greek alphabet. So what Jesus was saying, I'm the beginning and I'm the end. Everything else that exists, exists within those boundaries. I'm the beginning of eternity. I'm the beginning of humanity. I'm the end of creation. I am the end and the purpose for your life. I'll be there when your life on earth ends. I am the beginning of everything and I am the end of everything. I am the Alpha and the Omega. Letter B, God is the beginning and the end of all existence, including all humanity and all history. So Jesus saying that I am the Alpha and the Omega is making an amazing claim about the biggest endeavor of all time, the human story. He was saying that he was there present when everything began. Jesus was there before this universe came into existence. He was there when he created the universe. He put the earth within this particular galaxy in the universe such that it could support human life. And he said he'll be there when our time on earth is done. He's the first letter of the human saga, the Alpha, and he's the last letter of the last paragraph of our life. The Omega. Could also be a time for us to make a new commitment. We could have a new beginning today. If you're not satisfied with your relationship with God and the way your life is going today, you can mark today on a calendar, and today can be your Alpha. It can be a new beginning for you in Christ. So we might be asking today, what is the meaning of life? And Jesus said, I am. So we might be asking, what is the meaning of life? And Jesus said, I am. Thank you. Letter C. Our life begins with God and our life ends with God. Literally, God is the creator of life. God is the giver of life. Our life would never come into existence except for the power and the will of God. And when our life on earth is done, we come face to face with God again. He's the beginning and the end, the bookends of our life. He's also the end of life in so much as he is our purpose for life. I want to be clear that our purpose on life isn't a purpose in life isn't defined with our accumulation of stuff or experiences or memories. That's not why we're here. That's good. It's nice to have nice stuff, but that's not our purpose. Your purpose on life, God puts you here specifically, knowing who you are with your particular constellation of genetic anomalies. I learned those big words this week. God made you to be exactly who you are so that you can get your work done on earth. Your purpose in life is accomplished when your life intersects the life of somebody else in a meaningful way. Here's the message of the Bible. The basic message of the Bible is this. How is it that mortal man can be reconciled to Almighty God? And there's also a really strong subtext underneath that of real world compassion. God gets his work in the world done through us. And that's the purpose of life. So Jesus is the end. He's the reason. He's the purpose that we exist. So letter D. He has sovereign control over every person, object, and event. And nothing is outside his domain. In fact, I would suggest that even nothing is within his domain. He is the Alpha and the Omega. Everything else is contained within God. Number two, Jesus also said, I am the light of the world. Letter A, the darkness of evil never has and never will overcome God's light. God's light is Jesus Christ. And he overcame evil. And in the Bible, darkness and light are common metaphors. Light refers to Jesus Christ. Light refers to truth. Light refers to goodness. Darkness refers to the prince of darkness, the enemy. It refers to sin. It refers to evil. Those are common themes. And here Jesus is saying, I am the light of the world, the light of the truth, who beat darkness and evil. Letter B. When we follow Jesus, we can avoid walking blindly and falling into sin. So in addition to being our goodness and our purpose, he also said, I'm going to guide you. I will be your guiding light through this life. Years ago, my eldest son moved down to San Diego because he was going to attend Point Loma University. And after like his second week in San Diego, he never went to college. He ran away with a rock and roll band. And they went on this nationwide tour. They packed up an RV and had a camper, a trailer or something they pulled behind them. And they went on a nationwide tour. And I remember he ended up in January in Buffalo, New York. Some of you have been to Buffalo, New York. And I'm his dad. And I love him more than I can describe. And I got to tell you, it was a really insecure feeling. Thinking he's 3,000 miles away, literally across the continent. Who's going to protect my son in January in Buffalo? And Jesus said, I am. Now, similarly, when we had little tiny boys, when they were much, much younger, we wanted to take the boys, we took them camping. And we decided while we were camping, we're going to be out on take a little expedition and go spelunking. We wanted to go caving. So we paid our admission, and this guide took us down to this cave, and we saw rooms full of cave bacon and stalactites and stalagmites and all of the cave stuff. If you ever get a chance to go, go. It was a wonderful experience. But we got probably, a quarter of a mile or a half mile into this cave, and the guide said, would you like to experience total darkness? I went, yeah. So she said, okay, put your pagers away, because that's about how long ago it was. So we put our pagers in our pocket, and we put our watches in our pocket, we put our phones away. She said, make sure you're making no light yourself. And they turned the lights in the cave off. And there was nothing. I waved my hand in front of my face. I could not see a thing. And she said, would you like to find your way out? And they flipped a switch, and this little rope light, kind of like this, lit up along the side of the path to help us find our way out. And I thought, there's a metaphor there. I remember the times in my life when I was capable of getting in so dark and so deep, so quickly, that without the light of God to guide me out, I never would have made it out. And that's what Jesus means by the light of the world. He is goodness. He's overcome the darkness of evil. But in addition, when we're going through life, he's the light along the path that'll guide our way. And we get ourselves in deep and dark, he'll guide us out. So let it be, when we follow Jesus, we can avoid walking blindly and falling into sin. So sometimes I might ask, when I feel lost and I feel like I'm in despair and in darkness, God, will you take my hand? And Jesus said, I am. Number three, Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. And letter A, we are his prized possessions. Right? Because that's the purpose of a shepherd. The whole deal with a shepherd is to keep the sheep alive. If he can't keep the sheep alive, he has no reason for a job. If he doesn't have a job, he's not going to exist. Well, Jesus is described as the good shepherd. And he loves us, and he values you, and you are his prized possession. And like a good shepherd would lay down his life for the sheep, Jesus laid down his life for you. Like the good shepherd values the sheep and prizes the sheep, God values you. God created the world to support human life. And then when we were unable to live lives sufficient so we could spend eternity with God, God came to earth in the form of a human and volunteered to be murdered, brutalized, and pay the price for our sin so that we could spend eternity with him. Literally laid down his life for his sheep. That's how much he loves you. This is personal. The good shepherd loves you, made you to be specifically who you are, and died for you personally because he wants to spend eternity with you. Letter B, he guides us and he protects us and he cares for us. And when we're lost, he comes looking for us. So remember that story about Cameron in Buffalo, New York? And I was wondering, while my son is 3,000 miles away, who's going to protect him? And Jesus said, I am. So Cameron called me from Buffalo and he told me, there's a bunch of dumb kids in Buffalo, New York, told me they were in this club. They're Christian boys, but they played nightclubs. And he said, it was like 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. We're wrapping up our cables and putting our equipment away. And through the smoke of this nightclub, this person emerged. It was really surreal. I could see in a movie script. He's walking down the aisle, and you could see him come, kind of come into the light out of the smoke. And he goes, are you guys so-and-so band X? And they go, well, yeah, we are. He goes, oh, some of the kids from my church were telling me about you. They were here to see you. And I'm a pastor over there, and God laid on my heart that I should come down here and maybe see what I can do to support you. Are you fellas hungry? And they went, what? As a matter of fact. Because at that point, they were out of food. And they were out of money. And they'd run out of gas in the RV. And their next show was in Atlanta, Georgia. So here they are in January in Buffalo, not knowing how they're going to get to Atlanta. And God sent one of you through that smoky bar, and he said, can I buy you a pizza? And he fed the boys pizza, and he bought them groceries and filled their cupboards, and he gave them enough gas to make it to Atlanta. Like a good shepherd, God takes care of us, whatever we're going through in life, and he gets that done through the body of Christ. He cares for you, he cherishes you, and you are his prized possession. And letter C, he laid down his life for ours. Because he loves you so much, he died so that he can spend eternity with you. So maybe I'm feeling unlovable, and I wonder, is anyone able to love me? Jesus says, I am. When my son's far away from home, and I'm feeling that insecure feeling as a father, I wonder, who's going to protect my son? Jesus says, I am. Number four, Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. So letter A, he's our source. It's like the vine provides nutrients and life to the branches that are attached to the vine. He is our source. He strengthens us and he sustains us. You know, we sang a song that was based lyrically on Isaiah 40:31, which says, but for those who trust in the Lord, he will change their circumstances. Okay, it doesn't really say that, does it? It says this, those who trust in the Lord, he will renew their strength. And they'll rise up on wings like eagles. And they'll run, and they won't get weary. And they'll walk, and they won't faint. So God will sustain us through life events. He doesn't promise to change our circumstances. Sometimes he does. What he does promise is, I will give you what's required to make it to the next moment. And you continue to trust me, and I'll get you to the next moment. God will sustain us through our life events. He's the vine that sustains us. Letter B, he nourishes us toward our purpose, which is to bear fruit. We already talked about that purpose of life, and God gives you the nourishment so that your life can intersect the lives of other people in meaningful ways. So you can make the difference in the lives of other people right here in this community and demonstrate the love of God to them. And letter C, we cannot fulfill our purpose unless we remain in intimate connection with Him. So when we feel farther away from God, what can we do to feel more connected? How can we remain connected intimately with Almighty God? Here's a couple simple things you can do. One is read your Bible every day. Reading your Bible tells you who God is. You learn His personality. You learn His priorities. We learn God's values. And then pray every day. Stay in spiritual connection with God by praying. And then thirdly, be connected with a body of believers. Come to church regularly. Get involved in the lives of your church family outside of Sunday mornings. Let's do life together. Shoulder to shoulder, we'll get through this stuff together, and God uses us to keep each other strong and close to Him. We can't fulfill our purpose in life without staying intimately connected with God. We can start our intimate connection by reading our Bible every day, praying every day, and being connected with His family. So sometimes in life, I feel far away from God, and I pray, and I wonder, is anybody listening? And Jesus says, I am. And number five, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Letter A, I'm here to provide you with everything you need. And letter B, I am the sustenance of your spiritual life. You know, Jesus said that very soon after the miracle of feeding thousands of people with, you know, five loaves and a couple of small fish. That happened, and then Jesus kind of escaped and went across the lake, and he got chased down by those same people. And they wanted to see that happen again. They kind of asked him, would you do that whole loaves and fishes thing again? And Jesus said, you know, you only want to see the signs and wonders. And they talked about, well, God made manna in heaven. Look what you did with fishes and loaves. And that's when Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. So they chased him down because they were hungry and they wanted to eat again. And what he gave them was a spiritual lesson, that he will give us sustenance in our spiritual life. And he'll give us the ability to live forever in eternity with him. And I think sometimes in my life, the amount of energy that I apply to my financial life and my relational life and keeping myself healthy. And I wonder, is the amount of energy I spend maintaining the health of my spiritual life out of balance? So if it is for you, would you reflect on that real quickly? And maybe this could be a new start with this new year to apply sufficient energy in that area of your life as well. So if you think, okay, I know how much time I spent staying healthy and eating and making money, are you spending sufficient time in your spiritual life? So sometimes I ask God, I'm going through a tough time. And right now I just hate the way that I feel. Will you give me the strength to endure? And Jesus says, I am. Sometimes I pray, God, will you transform me from the person that I am into the person that you want me to be? And Jesus says, I am. Number six, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. So letter A, believers in Jesus, even though they die, will live again. Letter B, the believer will never experience spiritual death. This is an amazing claim, and it's also a tremendous source of hope. Because of what Jesus did, coming to earth in the form of a man, living a perfect, sinless life, and volunteering to die a brutal death on our behalf, because he did that, we can live forever with him in eternity. Now, we all know our physical bodies are going to die. When this good life is over, though, we get to meet him again because he paid our price. So when we pray, God, will you take me with you into eternity? Jesus says, I am. If you'll allow me, I'd like to invite my wife, Alana, to come join me up here. And she's going to share a song with you. And it's a song that she could have written. She didn't write it, but she could have written it because it's really kind of a part of her testimony. The lyrics of this song really tell the story of her life. So we put together some pictures to go along with the song that kind of demonstrate what's going on in the lyrics of the song. But I want to let you in on a secret. There comes a point in those pictures during the chronology of this person. This song tells a life story. During the chronology of the life, there's a point where the young lady in this story gets married, and there's a picture of a bride up there. That's really her. So from that point forward, all the pictures really are of Alana, and this really is kind of her story, and it talks about what I am means in really practical ways through the course of a lifetime. Would you enjoy this with me?
Can scream too much, it might seem.